Today, on the Australian Photography Show, we're going to one of the most famous locations in Australia, the Pinnacles, with photographer Adam Monk, who's an expert at landscape photography. And together, we're going to teach you how to become a great landscape photographer. Adam Monk is one of Australia's best landscape photographers, creating stunning images of Australia's scenery with multiple exposures, photo stitching and hours of post-production processing for each shot. Today, I'm meeting him at the world-famous Pinnacles, where he's going to help you become a better landscape photographer so your holiday photos blow your friends away when you get home.
Look at that. There's so much here. You don't know where to start, really, do you?
This is a fantastic spot, Steve.
I know.
One of my favourite places.
How often do you go on holidays and you come back and you look at your photos and you go, oh my God, they're terrible, I've ruined it all. Well, what we're going to do today is we're going to show you how to take great photographs while you're on holidays. And I'm with Adam Monk. He's from Fremantle and he's a renowned landscape photographer. We're here at the Pinnacles, 200 kilometres north of Perth. There are a bunch of rocks, but they're some of the most spectacular rocks you're ever going to see. And Adam is going to teach us how to take great landscapes when you're on holidays. And Adam, have you taken photos here before?
I have, Steve. Not for quite a few years, but I certainly have. It's almost endless, the possibilities here.
It is. We've got really flat light today with some cloud cover, which I love for a dramatic sky. But hopefully, you're going to make me a better photographer, and everyone watching at home is going to walk away and go, I want to come to the Pinnacles, or I want to go on holidays and take great landscapes.
I hope so, Steve. That's the idea.
He's really very modest, but this is going to be fun. Let's go, mate. Over here, I think the rocks begin. Look, there's one. There's another one. There's certainly
rocks, rocks everywhere.
There is. Adam, I guess one of the things that is going to be daunting to people is you're in a place that's full of 1,000 million rocks. How do you try and separate one? This is the biggest rock in the area and I kind of like this sort of thing. Is this what you're looking for, something big like this?
Well, this is the obvious thing to shoot, isn't it, Steve? Because it is, as you say, it's the biggest thing here.
Giant sort of thing in the background?
Yeah, you could shoot through it. You could use a bit of the structure here and give yourself some foreground. But it's probably not really what I would shoot.
Well, let's go and find something that you would shoot and you can tell me why you'd shoot that, yeah?
All right, so let's go.
Because I see 10,000 rocks. Yeah. And to, I guess, the untrained eye, they just look the same.
Right.
So this is more what you had in mind, yeah?
The main thing about this landscape is it's very monochromatic. In simple terms, just about everything's the same colour.
Right.
Whereas here we've got this lovely splash of green. Now there's a few bushes around as well, but they tend to look a bit ragged.
Yep. So how are you going to shoot? Are you going to get down low? You've lost the hat too, so you're serious now, right?
Oh yeah, yeah, I had to take the hat off. I'll keep knocking it off. Well, we've got this fantastic, very pointy rock behind. It looks a bit like a witch's hat.
Yep.
And we've got this beautiful sky with all these white streaks of cloud all going crazy. So if we can go right down low, down here somewhere, get this grass in the extreme foreground at the bottom of the shot, okay, which gives us that nice big patch of green colour. We've got the detail of this amazing rock up here just on the edge, and we've got this fantastically pointy one further back with this wild sky above it.
There's lots to see.
There's heaps to see.
And you're going to shoot it portrait mode?
I'm going to shoot it portrait because I want a lot of sky in the shot.
And you're getting it at about 16 mil, so you've got very wide angle
lens.
This
is a very wide angle lens, 16 mil on a full frame.
Yep.
So we're looking at a vast a vast panorama effectively in vertical.
Yep.
The trick is focus on this.
You mean the grass right in front?
Right in front, because if that's out of focus, we're going to lose the impact of the shot.
Oh, okay.
Because we need this to walk us into the shot. It actually doesn't matter if that pinnacle is a little bit blurry, and the sky, of course, is out of focus effectively anyway,
yep,
because it's cloud. So that's the key thing. So the key thing is to take your metering off there.
Yep.
So put your camera on manual, take your metering off there, focus on there, and then frame your shot. So I'm focusing there first, then I'm lifting up my shot to put that in the bottom right-hand corner, and firing it off.
Very nice. That's a lot of preparation. And f-stop?
F-16 on that one.
So lots of depth of field, so you get as much in as possible. And with lots of nice light, 100 ISO, you're still going to get a great
beautiful result. Light. We've still got the light coming from here too.
Yeah.
So we've got a nice side light going on, which is adding a little bit of depth to this.
Yep.
It's adding depth to that pinnacle back there.
Yep.
And it's adding form and texture to this here. It's nice and bright.
Well, look, I'm going to go over there and go crazy. Let's see what we can come up with here, eh?
All right, I'll play around with this for a while.
Beautiful.
Hey, Steve.
Yeah.
Don't walk in my shot.
I'm walking out of your shot. That's a fantastic landscape.
It is, isn't it?
What's that? I've never seen one of those precisely.
Oh, this is sort of the old school, actually, Steve. This is actually a film camera. It's a 6x17.
Whoa, look at that. That's your frame size.
That's the frame size. So that's the actual, it uses a 120 roll of film. Four shots to a roll.
Four shots to a roll?
Four shots to
you a roll. You want to make sure you don't blow them, don't you?
Yeah, it works out to be about $10 to $12 every time I push the shutter on this.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Could we maybe put your hand in your pocket and shoot a few?
Yeah, well, that's what I was thinking of.
If you blow it, I'll pay for it. Oh, really? So, essentially just a one-shot type of panorama, yeah?
It's a single shot, so it's an extremely wide-angle lens. The lens isn't moving.
Yep.
So it's not good for shooting people. It tends to distort them rather radically.
It's quite apparent when you look through Adam's work that through the use of wide formats, either directly from the negative or by stitching multiple exposures, he's created a style that's uniquely his own. If you want to start creating your own style of landscape photography, a good place to start is by experimenting with the type of lens that you use for each shot. Because sometimes with landscapes, the widest lens is not necessarily the answer.
Okay, so we've taken some great photos already, but mainly with wide-angle lenses. And Adam, I'm actually a sort of landscape photographer that uses mainly tallies, which is a bit weird, I know. You've actually been using the widest of wide-angle so far, 16 to 35.
16 to 35, yeah, Steve. It's a very, very wide lens.
I've got a 24 to 70. So why don't we shoot the same landscape with different lenses, including some tallies, mm-hmm, and actually feel the difference, yeah?
All right.
So, after you.
Okay, well, to start with, for something extremely wide, you're in danger of creating a shot that's not interesting at all.
Exactly, you can lose the whole focus, yeah?
Because even just standing here, everything in the shot is pretty small.
Right.
There's not much going on.
Nope.
And I can see your shadow, I can see your feet, I can see... So I'm encompassing a very, very wide area. So with a lens this wide, in my opinion, my style anyway, is to step forward and grab a nice piece of texture.
Without my head in it, right?
Without your head in it, preferably, yes. Something with extreme foreground that really sits in the front of the shot. And that then tends to walk you into the shot. It gives you something that's right up in your face.
Now, what I like to do, sorry to interrupt you there, but that's obviously an outstanding way to go. I use it a little bit differently. I'm going to go for a 70,
yep,
and I like to actually focus hard on a point. Mm. And make the background almost superfluous, or maybe focus on something in the distance and make my foreground shot completely out of focus.
Yeah.
And that to me gives you more of a dramatic shot. So that's a 70mm, which is sort of a telephoto lens. Let's stick some bigger lenses on and really show them what we can do with that.
Sure thing.
I noticed you've gone and smuggled my lens and put on your camera there. That's a 7200 really fast Canon with the ultra stabilizer. I love that lens. What do you reckon?
That's very nice. I think this is on my shopping list.
Have you shot much landscape with the telly?
Not much landscape, mainly people.
Yeah, great
very
for that.
For people.
Yeah, I like it because I can actually, let's say my focal point is something over here.
Yep.
I like to be able to make that my focus or make something in the distance my absolute focus. And with a tally, you get that shallow depth of field that I think tells a story.
That's a pretty sexy looking lens you got on that.
Oh, I tell you, is this the funkiest looking lens from the front you've ever seen on a camera? Carl Zeiss 85mm 1.4 for the Canon. Mm. Oh, camera house is lovely. They gave me this to play with it. I really like it. Do you want to rattle off some over there? Try different sort of different focal points. And I like the way that you can tell a story about just a point.
I like being able to pick out, in this case, one pinnacle.
Yeah.
Everything else, I've got this on 2,000th of a second with 5.6. I actually don't need the image stabilizer on that.
It's a super fast lens. I've done some amazing things with that.
So this is shooting at 2.8. So
the depth of field will be insanely short.
Very, very short. So, and it's also compressing all the background. So I'm getting a very, very sharp, very dramatic foreground piece.
Can you see why I like it now?
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of a thing that I use as a point of difference from other landscape photography I see. Is that obviously most landscapes are large depth of field, show everything, whereas I tend to go, that thing over there, that's what I really want to shoot. For example, a point on top of a pinnacle.
Yep.
And focus on that, but also try and tell a story with the out of focus foreground or background too.
Yeah, the bits that are, it works very well.
Frame the focal point with the blurriness, almost leading your eye to it.
Yes, it's very nice. I think I could get used to this lens.
Don't get too used to it.
Your bag might be a bit lighter tonight, Steve.
Yeah, I'm used to that. Well, Adam, I don't think you could want a better backdrop than this to spend a day with the camera, could you?
No, Steve, it's pretty good. Pretty good.
We've taken some fantastic photos today. The backdrop's got a lot to do with it, but also your tips were fantastic. I actually started using the green in front of the rocks to offset it, and that's something I never thought of before. I really like it.
Oh, good. I'm glad I could help.
And I hope everyone at home learned something as well. And if you are in Perth or come to Perth, drive the 200Ks or get on a tour and come to the Pinnacles, because if you've got a camera, there's not too many better places than this to take a photograph in Australia. I'd like to thank Adam for his terrific advice about landscape photography, and I hope you enjoyed it too. On the next episode, Rob Miller is going to teach you how to take amazing portraits as we head to Death Row. Thanks for watching. I hope you can join us again for that.
Butterfly. I've danced through life with diamonds on my feet. A long road that runs right to my destiny.